I've been waiting for you a long time.
I'm the clever one.
The doctor and I are going to play a little game together.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Time Ram, the podcast type thing, as modern people understand them, where we mash up Doctor Who eras with doctors that should never have had them in them. Tonight, we've got an interesting one. It's interesting in one way. It's not interesting in another way, because it's Celestial Toymaker, which is the most fantastically boring Hartnell story there is. it's the only Hartnell story I'm possibly not that much of a fan of. And with me, I have Mr. Paul Ferry, who, funnily enough, is dressed entirely like Adam and the Ants.
Yes.
And over there in a different part of the country is Mr. Barry Williams, who's come as Kajagoogoo.
Pretty good.
What do we think about this in the Matt Smith era, then?
Yeah, It would be entirely different, I think.
I think it would kind of have to be.
Yeah,
it's going to be shorter. It's going to be visually able to do the story justice. It's just a win for the Smith era. So that was Time Ram, everyone. Thanks for listening. Glad you had a good night. Bye.
Night.
I was thinking, as I was watching this, but I'm not going to lie. I haven't watched it again for this because I just watched it a couple of weeks ago with the animation. But I was thinking it would be kind of. They'd go more down the computer games angle. It'd be more like Tron, I think, than the Celestial Toymaker.
You think so? I don't think it would. It's not that long ago.
I think.
In terms of
actual games they're having to go through.
In terms of the look of it, looking as if they're inside a computer game. I think that's how they'd do it in 2010.
Games like Hunt the Thimble. I mean, kids don't know what those are anymore. Nobody does that anymore.
And I was thinking the Toymaker might even be like, you remember Patrick Moore in Games Master, wasn't it?
Uh-huh.
Where he was this huge floating head.
Floating head.
I was thinking the Toymaker might be like that.
I mean, you know me, Paul. I'm always down for a huge floating head.
I suppose
what we have here is quite an interesting conversation about, theoretically taking the basis of this idea and bearing it, in the Matt Smith era, we can approach visualizing this in a lot of different ways.
Yeah.
I think you'd have it like different zones then, like the Crystal Maze. So you'd start off with the scary Victoriana. Which they use in one with the dolls, the Mark Gatiss one. It's totally valid for that era. I think you'd get that for part of it. Probably the Toymaker's office, which kind of is scary Victoriana in a big fucking void. It's where it's one massive bit of scary Victoriana in a corner in a massive void. You can get the surrealism that you got in the animation recently.
Yeah.
You could totally do that, do the entire thing on green screens with set pieces and so on. So I suppose you'd have the game, you'd have the blind man's buff thing, you'd have it kind of half that, half a game of Tetris, wouldn't you? You'd have them all moving about, there'd be CGI blocks that they'd have to jump on and get around and work out where they were going to be next.
Yeah.
If they had been out, they'd actually code this as a game and release it at the same time, but they wouldn't have done that.
It is more like the sort of thing that you get the BBC website doing. A little sort of tiny pixelated Matt Smith jumping from block to block.
Maybe they'd go down the route of it being like them having to move forward through the sort of history of games. So it starts with some sort of starts with like chess or something, a chess-based challenge, and then it goes to like a Victorian parlor game, then it goes to like a
They
1970s
give
board
it
game.
some kind of progression.
I'd love to see that episode of Ace of Wands that doesn't exist, where he's like facing off against massive chess pieces that keep smacking into him. I'd love to see that. So can we have that? Since the Ace of Wands doesn't exist, can we have massive chess pieces?
It's a bit Harry Potter,
Just
but yeah, I
smacking
guess
in. Is it Harry Potter? It's not,
Harry
it's Ace
Potter
of
does
Wands.
it.
I bet she saw that. I bet she saw that Ace of
Probably.
Wands episode and went, I'll have that one day.
Yeah.
Must remember when I'm in my teens, I must go in and make sure all those tapes are wiped. Cunt.
Isn't there? I don't know. I was going to say, isn't there actually an episode of the Avengers? But I think it's actually just a photo shoot of them
Oh, the
standing on
chessboard.
a
There was a
chessboard
title sequence for the
with enormous
Americans,
chess.
wasn't it? Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it
It's the
wasn't an
sort of thing you'd
episode, was it? It
expect
was
to have been in the
just for the
Avengers. In one of the colour ones, in the rig, or the Thorson, more like a person when they were just going completely off it. You can kind of imagine that there was, that happening. But let's have it for this anyway. What the hell? In the name of Ace of Wands, Let's change it.
down with J.K. Rowling.
Changing it's the right thing to do because I mean this story has such a the production history is more interesting than the actual story, really.
It's
Because
yeah. I mean, it really is. And
apparently
then
John Wiles and Donald Tosh, this was going to be their story to kind of set up their vision of Doctor Who, how they were going to do it. And then they'd been there. They'd only been there less than 6 months, and they were going
I
to
think
use the
Master
story.
Plan fucked them, didn't it? I mean, Master Plan by the end of it, I think John Wiles was going, why am I fucking bothering? I can't win. And
Well,
Hartnell, him and
yeah,
Hartnell, not getting on.
they weren't getting on. John Wiles was just ignoring Master Plan. He just left it up to Douglas Camford. He wasn't even interested. But yeah, then they tried to get rid of William Hartnell, didn't they? They were going to try and
Well,
replace
that was the thought.
William
That's the
Hartnell.
thing, yeah. It's
They
made
did that in
invisible.
like November 65. I've been looking at the production. November 65, they tried to get rid of Hartnell, and then that doesn't work out. The boss says no. And then so in December, they both, Donald Tosh and John Wiles, both resigned from the BBC. December. They'd
Literally
been,
from the BBC. He says, all right, fuck this shit.
exactly. They just left the
Far away
corporation.
as possible. Yeah, it's incredible. It's a bizarre time. I love what they make, even though they kind of half don't make it. They certainly haven't commissioned it.
They got nothing done. They've
I
been there less
can
than six
totally
months at
understand
that
their
point.
frustration. Totally.
If I was brought onto Doctor Who and it was all my thing and I had loads of ideas and oh, by the way, you've got to do these episodes and it's 12 of them and it's Daleks, which you're not even interested in. It'd be like someone saying to me, yeah, you've got to do like 10 episodes of Coronation Street in the middle of your series of Doctor Who. What?
And then,
So,
and then Celestial Toymaker, obviously Brian Hales wrote the script. He wrote the original script. And Donald Tosh asked him to include these characters called George and Margaret, who were supposedly taken from a play, but from the head of SEALs by Gerald Savory, who wrote this play called George and Margaret, in which they never actually appear. So he thought it'd be a funny joke to have this George and Margaret in there. But then it didn't find favour with Jerry Davis. He says that he read it and he said it was like a Noel Coward thing. It's like it wasn't right at all.
You see, we're talking, okay, what, like the Mythmakers then, which is great. I think Jerry Davis didn't appreciate that. I
It
think the
wasn't
original
his
version
thing.
might actually be really good. I think it had been like that they were good at wit, they were good at comedy and stuff like that.
But yeah, he didn't find favour with Jerry Davis.
No.
Gerald Savory withdrew permission to use George and Margaret at the last minute. Possibly, I think Jerry Davis might have persuaded him, because all you have to do is change the character names.
As pointed out in that tremendous Terry Nation Army video, it makes no difference. You change them, that is it.
He changed the
So
names
all
in
this
front.
fuss and palaver, I don't get it.
But he doesn't
And
do that. He gives himself a week to rewrite the entire script. And he puts in all these nursery games, and no wonder it's
it's
a
an
mess.
excuse, isn't it? It's just an
It's
excuse.
an excuse.
The whole Gerald Savory thing stinks, I think, thinking about it. I don't believe it. Because that is the solution. If you're any script editor at all, you'll just go, okay, so they're called Bob and Madge.
Is that it?
And that's it.
That's
But
it, yeah.
no, it's a complete rewrite, and it's just because he wants to.
And then when he was
And he's
leaving,
like a silly piper.
I was just going to say one last thing. When he was leaving on his last day, John Wiles actually put a memo in complaining about Celestial Toymaker and how it ended up as a complete mess, and he hated it. So that was interesting.
Yeah. I
So
think if they
what?
hadn't been on such
So
an incredibly, sorry, I was just going to say, I think if they hadn't been on such an incredibly tight turnaround, they'd probably have ditched it altogether, wouldn't they? And
yeah. They'd already
and just
cast it.
replaced it with something
At
else.
that point, they
They
had the
cast it.
set.
I suspect that set designing had been done, and once you've
Yeah,
started
yeah,
moving your sets, you don't stop. You know, yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Way too
it's
late.
such a so it's just a complete mess. It's padded to
Yeah,
hell. It hasn't got Hartnell in it for two episodes, who usually manages to lift stuff that's complete hell.
yeah.
It probably wasn't all that inspiringly directed to go by episode four.
Yeah.
That's the thing, we have actually got a bit to watch, and it's not Camfield,
No.
is it? You
No.
know, not even Richard
And
Martin.
yet, inexplicably, in the 80s, it had a cracker reputation.
Jeremy
And
Bentham.
I,
Yeah.
yeah.
I'm sure it was in Doctor Who Weekly. You know where they used to go through all the stories and like Ivan
Yeah.
Tracy, which was incredible. But you know, now it's like half a page of A4 of information and some photos. And I think he really liked
Yeah.
it. He really hated the gunfighters as well. So everyone said it was shit.
Yeah.
Not shit.
Yeah.
It's got some dodgy accents, but it's a
Yeah.
funny script and it's amazingly designed.
Yeah.
You
Yeah.
know. We were all brought up on that thing. Oh yeah, the gunfighters
Yeah.
are shit. Don't bother. You
Yeah.
know.
Yeah.
And the Celestial Toymaker is amazing, and it's just not. It really isn't.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, by far my least favorite 60s story.
Yeah.
And I love the 60s, you know, unreservedly. I can get behind stuff that's not particularly well liked, like the Ark. You know, I love it. Space Museum,
Yeah.
right? But the Toymaker, Michael Gough. We've got Michael Gough. Great,
Yeah,
that's something.
yeah. That's good. Yeah.
But that's about it. I suspect it would all be entirely as stagey and kind of embarrassing as episode four.
Yeah.
But not
A bit
now,
like a
because
Crackerjack pantomime.
Not
it's in the Matt Smith era, so it's going to be great. Yeah.
now. Not now.
Yeah.
Now it's going to be bursting with inventiveness and surrealism and menace around every corner. Who's playing a toy maker?
Michael McKenzie.
Michael McKenzie.
See. To go in there. In the Ace of Wands theme.
Has he got the gravitas for it? It wouldn't be
Probably
inventive.
not.
This is the sort of thing they'd go for, oh God, Burkhoff for.
Michael Caine, you know, I was going down the line of Alfred Butler's.
Wouldn't have thought Michael Caine.
No, okay, fair enough.
John Connery, sure, you like
Sean
games.
Connery.
Was he alive? I suppose he was, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was alive.
Yeah.
I know that's Trevor Eve.
Well, I
Was
mean, they'd
Trevor Eve.
never have
They wouldn't have
afforded
got
him,
Sean
you
Connery.
know,
There's no way Sean
even
Connery was
at
in
his
Hollywood.
advanced stage.
Roger Moore either. They wouldn't have got him
Come to the domain of the toy maker.
either. Yes.
This is where we decide whether you're an onshore large doctor. Yes, play the trilogic game. I shall play golf. Oh, that's our Sean Connery. What the hell?
Yes. Yeah.
Time Ram, it's all complete fantasy anyway. What the hell? Why shouldn't we have Sean Connery?
Yeah. Yes.
Better have a stupid
Can we have
book.
Barbara Windsor as the various female parts in it? Mrs. Wiggs and so on. Get out of my fairy tale kitchen, that sort of.
Then who's the male character then? Who's
I don't know. Guy Siner.
okay.
I was going to say Windsor Davies,
Windsor
but
Davies. Windsor
I think
Davies.
Windsor Davies might have been dead by then.
Windsor Davies, of course it's Windsor Davies. Windsor Davies,
He's still
Bart.
alive? When
Barbara
did he
Windsor. He
die?
might have been. He lived quite a while, didn't he?
Should find out. We haven't actually decided which part of the Matt Smith era it's set in. This might decide it.
It might, yeah. There is 2019. He was alive for
Oh, right,
ages.
Windsor Davies. We've got Windsor
Yeah.
Davies, Barbara
Oh, he
Windsor,
wasn't
and then
another.
Sean Connery. It's a bit star-studded, this is. Who's playing Cyril then? All the Cyril parts.
Well, it still doesn't turn up
Don
till later on.
Estelle, it's
Maybe.
got to be Don Estelle.
Yeah,
He definitely was dead,
Was
unfortunately
he? Oh.
enough. I
We'll
think so.
show that
I'll
last time.
double check that, but I don't think he was there.
Declan Mulholland.
See, a
He was
perfect
dead.
person for it would be Matt Lucas, but we can't use Matt
Matt
Lucas.
Lucas. Why can't we use him?
Yeah,
No. Can't we use
because
him?
he's Nardole.
Patton
Is
Oswalt. Patton Oswalt.
he?
He'd be good. Can we use Patton Oswalt?
Yeah.
Bit
Who?
American. Patton Oswalt is great.
Oh, he's a Pavlov's dog. I was thinking, okay, that's surreal. I don't quite get that one, but fine. I'll go with it. Compared to that, once I understand it.
You know what, Matt Smith probably could have get a Patton Oswalt. They'd get American stars in there. Be all
We've
right.
got Sean Connery in this. We're good. We're
You got
good.
Sean Connery, then Patton Oswalt's not a problem, surely.
Yeah. Fuck yeah.
Don Estelle died in 2003, by the way, so he would have come by then.
Okay, good. Excellent cast. Liking it.
Right, okay.
So, when are we setting it? Who's the companions? I suppose it's going to be Amy and
Well,
Rory, isn't it? Because they'll fit brilliantly.
probably,
Yeah.
yeah. I mean, season six is available because we've only really, in the Matt Smith era, we've only put stories in
It's
five and seven at the
this is a
moment. So,
season sixer, isn't it? This absolute
yeah.
yeah, why not
Stinking
stick it in the
season
middle?
six.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know where in season six, but somewhere in season six.
Nah, somewhere in season six.
It's somewhere in the middle.
Is
In
the
the middle.
Nymon one in season six?
We haven't put any in season six yet.
No, in the original season six.
The
The
God
Nymon.
Complex.
God Complex.
Oh yeah, God Complex. You can stick it in
It's
there.
that sort of era. It's
Yeah.
that sort of story to me, isn't it? It's in that sort of slot. Mid-season, before a big finale.
You could set it in a sinister hotel even. Yeah. Might even work better.
Cheaper to film.
Yeah.
Oh,
Which
yeah. Let's face it, they're going to have to save some money on the visuals now with that cast. Jesus.
It's looking fucking
I mean, Sean wants an
expensive.
actual golf course built into the studio, so he literally just potter over there and play golf because he's like well-oiled man. Yeah.
That's the exciting thing. Nobody in the universe can do what we're doing.
The story as it stands opens with the Doctor, Amy, and Rory all in the TARDIS
Yes.
when the Doctor disappears.
Yeah.
Goes invisible, man. They tell someone it's an attack, but he manages to get Amy to land the TARDIS. They land in the toy room.
I think you can cut to the chase here. We could cut a little bit. You could have the Doctor vanishing, and he's literally vanished from there. He isn't there at all when the TARDIS materializes somewhere, and they open the doors and he's out there just straight away. I think
He's
that's
already outside.
how you can mean.
Okay, cool. We need a kind of a cliffhanger, don't we? Sort of a pre-credit cliffhanger. We need a sort of dramatic exclamation point here.
Well, I suppose you could have the TARDIS landing, Amy and Rory emerge. You don't know the Doctor isn't there yet. You don't see him, and they're just in nothing. Absolutely nothing at all. Now they're actually walking out and standing on it, so you can see that they're standing on nothing. It's perspective. And just out and out and out and out and out, and out until they're tiny and it's bigger. Oh,
Or
shit. People have turned up and interfered with my golf. Test them for their lingerie.
just a trail of lights from the Apollo in the middle of the nothingness or something like that.
Yeah.
Quite fun. Yeah, you could do stuff like that. Excellent. Okay, yeah, so the Doctor, I guess, reappears. And the toy maker arrives.
This is your Dr. Light, isn't it?
It is kind of your
Yeah,
Dr. Light.
totally your Dr. Light.
It is. So perhaps
Although
it's more
Moffat
like
didn't tend to do them as much, did he? Oh, there is
they
some,
did
I
it in that
suppose.
season. There's one where the girl who waited, that's a
Yeah.
Dr. Light
Oh,
one because it's only in the TARDIS.
So maybe they should replace her instead.
All right.
Yeah.
Great.
How is Sean going to be dressed?
It's going to be
I'm thinking
just as
kilt.
Chinese Mandarin. No, he's not.
Yeah. I'm thinking full Scottish.
Full Scottish
I'm
kilt.
thinking the full Scottish
I was hoping a
kilt.
reflective silver cone. It could be all of these things apart from the racist
Funny enough, the script describes him as Occidental, so he's not meant to be playing a Chinese character.
He could, well, we could just do the floating head. We could have it as Sean Connery's floating
Floating head, floating Sean
head.
head. Yes.
That solves all the problems, doesn't it?
Because then he only has to
There we
be in a
go.
sort of a head studio for like a day.
Usher floating Sean Connery head, watching you.
Yes.
Created a trilogy, Game of a Shadow, production. Yes.
That's like when they got Ian McKellen to do a voice. It's fine because he's just
Yeah.
there for a day.
Just, yeah.
Yeah.
So there we go.
Cool.
So Sean finally gets to be Zardoz then, doesn't he?
He does indeed.
Yay. Yeah.
I try to suppress these thoughts, but they leak out through the head wound of my third death.
20th Century Fox presents a John Borman film.
Zardoz!
They make you old, but they don't let you die.
It took careful breeding to produce a slave who would free his masters.
Zardoz!
Vote, please. Sentence? George Seddon will be aged 5 years.
Yes, a bit frightening, isn't it?
Zardoz. Rated R. Under 17, not admitted without parent.
Yeah, so we get joint head. It's the toy maker,
Yes.
and yeah, he's showing scenes from Amy and Rory's past, which at this point presumably involves autons
No, that hasn't happened yet, has it? Oh, it's not going to happen anyway because time ram, it'll involve Ravelox and
Well, this
other
is why I
things.
mentioned autons, because they've been disappeared from space.
I thought you were jumping ahead to when Rory becomes an auton.
No,
Yeah.
nothing like that. No.
Ah, spearhead.
Yeah, they've done
Yeah,
spearhead. They've
spearhead. Yeah.
done Jesus. They've done.
I can't possibly be expected to remember these things, are
they've done the one with the spaceships smashed together. Nightmare of Eden. They've done
Nightmare of
that one.
Nightmare of Eden.
Yeah,
Yes.
so they've done it. So we get mandrels, visions of mandrels.
Excellent. We get autons and mandrels. That's a life lived, isn't it? Blimey.
It really is. We see Rory
If the
die a couple
toy
of times, you know.
they know how to party. Is he going to die in this as well? I think
Oh,
he should. Yeah.
If the toy maker's a giant head, can he first appear by being like a jack in a box? Just like a giant box.
Sean Connery.
And he
Sean
just pops
Connery
out.
in a
Like
box.
a massive Scottish Zebedee.
British eye. I was in the box. Yes.
It's time for bed now. But not for nonsense.
Shocking.
Blimey. Yeah, that's completely fucking unknown. Okay, so boing, that's the Sean Connery head. Greetings, Doctor.
How
Oh, he's
could
on
you
a
land a
spring.
picture of
Accessing
this?
the old kind of, oh, he's on the spring and waving his hands about. Yes, I'm on a spring.
Yeah,
I mean, really, at this point,
what of it?
Rory should just go, fucking hell. You know,
Yeah.
and just,
Yeah.
you know.
Roy should
Boy.
crap himself.
It's
Yes.
pre-watershed, but you know, fuck it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got Sean Connery and Patton Oswalt in it. This is not real. This is
Yes.
like some kind of bizarre fairyland. But anything can happen.
You're a bad man. You're a very bad man.
Yeah, so I mean, this is all a trick, basically. The toy maker's out to trick them. He's got loads of
Yes.
TARDISes. TARDISes pop up all over the place.
Yeah. It's going to be easy. That's going to be.
I guess a model shot in the 60s version, but yeah.
Well, it's not. It's not. It's not.
Yeah.
It's a shot from Marco Polo of the TARDIS on the plane of Premier set from a different angle. I can send you the photo if you like. The photo was found recently, and it's all marked up with China graph pencil as cut out. You know, print this bit and cut out here, and they literally just printed it again and again and again, and stuck them on card.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Guess it works.
And
Yeah.
that's been replicated in the new recon. They've used that photo. I checked.
Bloody hell.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. Recon facts. Great. So, yeah. And then the doctor vanishes, basically. The toy maker takes him off. So it's Amy and Rory for the win. Unfortunately, they're up against these clowns. Well, certainly in the original version, they're up against these clowns, Joey and
Yes.
Clara.
Yes. Well, I don't know. I don't know. I
I
mean,
don't know.
I think, like I say, if we're starting with the scary Victoriana, there's no reason why they can't still be clowns. They'd be more
Yeah.
elaborate than they were in the original. They might be slightly decaying in terms of the costumes, you know, drab and worn out and just a bit, you know, spider webby.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, what's his face have done them? Oh, Tim Burton.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Burton clowns, right? That sort of design ethic.
Yeah.
I think it's what you go for.
I mean, this whole story is
Yeah.
really slow, but I mean, it really runs out of steam somewhere around episode three, doesn't it? It kind of, you
Ah,
know,
that's charitable.
it's
That is charitable.
just kind of. Does anything
You're
happen
a
in
good man,
episode three?
that woman.
It really runs steam around the 10-minute mark.
Yeah. Fair enough. I mean, I've written down the plot here just for shits and giggles, but
I was thinking the plot's going to be fun.
We can literally take it any direction we like now. I mean, you know.
Yeah. So we can elaborate a bit on the design, maybe.
Yeah. Fun.
And keep cutting back to scenes of Matt Smith's hand talking to a massive Sean Connery head on a spring.
Mm-hmm.
Mint.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Good.
His hand just waving about.
Yeah, clearly. Absolutely. Yeah. Going off on one. I mean, yeah. It would be a bow tie, wouldn't it? That would still be there. Bobbing about like that. Hand and bow tie.
Hand and bow tie, yeah.
Waffling
yeah.
on about fish fingers and custard, but nevertheless, getting the moves right on the Trilogic game. Mm-hmm. Which I don't think you'd change. I think you'd keep the Trilogic game as a concept, wouldn't you? Why not?
Yeah, I mean, I'd
countdown.
Problem with that.
You mightn't have as many moves.
I mean, that's just a countdown, the Trilogic game.
It's a countdown, yeah.
Yeah,
so maybe it's 500 moves.
Yeah.
Or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, if you've only got 9 levels, it's 511 moves, isn't it?
You did maths at uni, didn't you?
I did.
Barry Williams has a degree in mathematics.
He is our James Burke.
Commercial time. They all say who is Doctor.
This is Tim Treloar.
This is David J. Howe.
I'm Peter Purvis.
I am Sadie Miller.
This is Lauren Cornelius.
Larry, it's Fraser.
For all things in the Doctor Who collecting world and beyond, the Doctor Who Collectors Podcast. I'm Larry Van Mersburg and your host, and I've been collecting for 42 years. You're listening to Time Ram on the Direction Point Podcast Network.
We need to kind of work out what they're going to be doing for the next middle chunk of this episode, which is good.
Yeah.
25 minutes, I'd imagine.
something
happening.
It's episode 3 that bores me the most. The whole kitchen bit, aren't the thimble. The chairs.
Yeah.
There's something going for that design-wise, at least, you know.
The chairs is more interesting. The hopscotch at the beginning, where the blind man's buff, as they call it, is, I mean, it's overlong, but it's not...
Not
as dull, you know.
We could make that a lot more visual as well, like I said earlier. But playing with what Paul said about games, you make it more like a Tetris sort of thing and have to leap between moving CGI animated stuff going on.
More of an actual obstacle course, something like that,
And well, you are blindfolded and it lies, you know, it catches you out and stuff like that. There'll be a lot of near falls. And it'll be like the adventure game, you know, if you fail, you're incinerated. Or you turn into a doll.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
You know, there'd probably be a sacrificial lamb. There'd probably be someone that they start this with, a villa type character who will just invent, who's been there for a long time, is desperate to get out, and who falls very early on and demonstrates exactly what happens. Visually, you know.
Well, there's the fool, isn't there? The fool turns up, but he runs away. He doesn't actually die.
Yeah, the fool isn't. I love that about the fool. Fuck that shit. the most intelligent person in the entire thing.
Yeah, I might be a fool, but I'm not an idiot. So maybe
Michael Keating.
He'd be up for it, wouldn't he?
The first challenge is that the sort of inexplicable assault course thing.
Where in the animation they kind of change the direction of gravity somehow, and they all kind of
That's what you'd do here. You'd Castrovalva the fuck out of it.
Castrovalva the shit out of that.
Castrovalva the shit out of it. Castrovalva was full of donches. I burned it. Or crushed the hatch. Etc. They win this.
Good.
See, and they're on to the next damn thing.
That's kind of
their story, isn't it? They just play these games and they win them.
That is the story, I mean, we're intercutting this with scenes in the Toymaker's realm, the Toymaker's area, where we have CG Sean Connery, who's just a floating head, and Matt Smith's hand.
Matt Smith's hand and bow tie.
Yeah.
And don't forget Connery's spring.
Right, okay.
Yes.
I think he should retain that. I think he should always be.
He should stand for the entire thing.
Gently dancing about like a massive deranged Scottish celebrity. Excellent.
These are going to be quite odd.
Violence. That'll be great. It'll be tremendous.
I don't know how we're going to bring him back like that in the giggle.
Yeah,
or
the
four,
giggle.
Yeah, it might be before this. You know,
it'll be before. It'll be Michael Goffin. 60.
This will be a sequel to the giggle. Yeah.
Occidental Toymaker. Yeah. In a totally undoable story.
So yeah. We should be casting Neil Patrick.
We
should be casting Neil Patrick Harris.
Sorry, what?
We should be casting Neil Patrick Harris then.
Oh, fuck Neil Patrick Harris. Sean Connery's better. Sean Connery. Would have given Neil Patrick Harris for his cake.
To be fair, he was probably doing How I Met Your Mother at the time. But
There you go. Sean Connery was free. All he was doing was golfing.
Yeah.
Occasional munch bashing.
Gosh, in his spare time.
With his golf club, it'd be like Vast Golf Inspired, but sort of more mature.
I believe that player is a launch.
Golfing launch basher.
Yes.
Take him out.
That launch is a 9-iron. Oh, excellent shot, sir. Yes.
All my travellings throughout the universe, I have battled against evil, against power-mad conspirators. I should have stayed here. The oldest civilization, decadent, degenerate, and rotten to the core. Power-mad conspirators, Daleks, Sontarans, Cybermen. They're still in the nursery compared to us. 10 million years of absolute power. That's what it takes to be really corrupt.
Anyway, so they play the chair game and they win that.
Yeah, I mean,
some time on it. I mean, I can't see how.
I don't know. Yeah, it's so little plot, isn't it? I mean,
they sit in the right chair. They don't sit in the wrong chair. This is what happens. Well, Dodo does sit in the wrong chair. That'd be
Dodo
boring,
does
it?
Sit in the wrong chair at one point. Yeah,
and Amy would just Scottish fury him out of it.
It's one of those inexplicably stupid moments, isn't it, when Dodo sits in the chair because she's just like, she's thinking about something and she sits down.
The story is not good for Dodo.
No.
It's not fantastic for anyone.
It's
really.
For Steven.
No.
Well, Hartnell comes out all right, but he had sense.
Yeah.
I bet he read it and just went, oh, I'm not feeling well. I need 2 weeks off going fishing, or I'll shout at you, John Wiles. I'll shout at you a lot. Yeah, go, Bill. You need a lie down. Yeah, I do.
Yeah, Bill must look at episodes 2 and 3 and just go,
yeah, and then just sitting at home going, yeah, I'm out of that.
No wonder Steven's got that look of disdain on his face throughout the animation.
He does seem genuinely pissed off.
The fart.
Just, yeah.
Yeah, the likenesses aren't great.
You get the impression that Peter Purvis isn't tremendously happy.
Yes.
I mean, he's carrying it again.
Yeah.
I think something that's very notable about that period is that John Wiles, Donald Tosh, many people, Douglas Camfield also said, thank fuck Peter Purvis, who would just carry it when he had to Bill had a massive chunk of script that made the next episode make sense. He'd find a way to sneak it in. And was reliable, and I absolutely think that's the case. You look at season 3, and you can see times when he's doing the heavy lifting.
Yeah.
I mean, Bill's out for like 2 episodes of Toymaker, but he's barely in Massacre as well, isn't he? He's out for an episode of that, and then he's only playing the Abbot.
The Abbot's not in it much.
No, it's just a few scenes.
I know it wasn't pre-filmed, but you could have perfectly easily pre-filmed all the Abbot stuff.
Yeah,
perfectly.
Yeah. Some really weird
choices.
Yeah, get made. Yeah,
it's a strange one. Did he really go downhill, or did he start losing parts? Is it a combination of both? Who knows? But yeah, it's different. Anyway, that's fine. He's flapping his hand about the green screen, which he did in one day. You know, half a day probably. And his voice is all done. His ADR's fine. You know, he's good. And Sean came in and did half a day just talking, you know, seeing things on a green screen. Boying one spring. And go on to the next game, and they win that.
They just took a 360 scan of his head.
Yeah.
Stuck him on a jack in a box.
But
not really, they wouldn't really do that. I mean, he was getting on a bit.
And maybe the toy was quite elderly by that point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
the toys were out that Christmas.
What you do is you put a green bib on that goes up there, and then you put a spring there, and you bounce your head on it, and that would totally work.
Yeah.
Okay, Sir Sean, and we want you to
Sir Sean. Yeah.
Come in here, wear your green sperm suit, and then bob your head about for us
on a spring. Yeah.
As if you're on a spring.
Yes, of course. Green reminds me of golf.
Did you ever see Launch Hunter?
Are we on to the next game? They're playing the next game. What is the next? Did you decide? Or is that enough games now? Is two enough, three, whatever it is?
Well, I mean, I think we said the first one would be kind of obstacle course type stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we can do something a bit more exciting than just picking musical chairs. I mean, I like the computer game. I like the computer game thing.
Yeah.
Well, they end up in a really strange place, and Patton Oswalt turns up, and he's there to combat them. And this,
he's dressed like one of the, just like Mario.
I suggest we're playing the dancers, just because that'd be visually interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. He says, "My name's Cyril, known to my friends as Mario." Mario.
And the BBC gets sued.
Yes.
And the script editor's sitting there going, "No, I just wrote a random schoolboy from the 1950s. Is he more of a Tucker Jenkins type? Is he more of a... because that's modern. It's not modern. I'm old.
I just wrote a random Italian plumber. That's it's got nothing to do with any computer games.
You could have the dancers as the kind of ghost type things from Pac-Man. Actually, you could have some really early 8-bit type
you
stuff
could do
going
that.
On. And you do, you know, you get through, you have to dance through a kind of Pac-Man maze type thing.
You could get Hungry Horace. They could probably afford Hungry Horace.
They probably could, but wouldn't anyone know what it was? Wasn't Hungry, was he? Horace went skiing.
That was the first one, was Hungry Horace. There's Hungry Horace. And then Horace goes skiing, I think. Or no, that's the last one. There's another one in between. Horace crosses the road or something.
Horace learns how to fly badly.
Horace gets the munchies. You know, it's
Okay, cool. So we get a bit of computer game history in there.
Yeah, yeah. I should probably explain for people who don't know. Hungry Horace is a computer game character that was on the ZX Spectrum in the early 1980s.
Blake 7 is 50 soon. Okay, they win.
I tell you one bit that works better in the existing episode 4 than the recon is the bit where they meet Cyril, or Cyril turns up at the end of episode 3, star episode 4. And he says to Stephen, "You're my hero, you are. I want to be just like you when I grow up." And Stephen says, "Really? You seem quite grown up already." And it really works in the existing episode because he's clearly the same. Well, he's older than Peter Purvis. He's just wearing a schoolboy outfit.
Absolutely. Apparently, there was a quick change. You saw him kind of going off and taking the chef's hat off, the cook's boy hat off, and putting the Cyril cap on. So it was very much made explicit that, he was playing a different part.
It's one of the weird things about the original version, isn't it? That Joey and Clara turn into these other characters, and there's no reference to the fact they've been played by the same actors.
Yeah, no, not at all. Cyril carried on through as clearly the same person.
It's a mess.
Okay, so we've got to the end bit and they win and they get the TARDIS back. Good.
Okay, the end. All right.
What about the chess match? The giant chess match
against Patton Oswalt. That's good.
Yeah, let's do a giant chess match. Yeah, that'd be good. Yeah.
Let's do that here. Good, good. That's more visual than the whole jumping between twats.
Tiles,
that's a better word,
Podiums,
Triangles.
Triangles.
Numbered triangles.
There is no sense of threat there, though, is there? He kind of, when it's he falls off into the electric.
And it's very speedy.
Bit of floor.
Really, very, if they built him a bit taller, and maybe floated dry ice between them, so you just couldn't see the floor for a start.
Yeah.
And you know what you're going to fall into. That could be, maybe.
Maybe.
But yeah, just him going, "It's electric and you'd be killed." It's a bit,
And then when he falls, it's kind of out of, he sort of falls out of shot and goes, "Ah!" And there's a little tiny little smoke bomb goes.
It's this is the sort of thing that doesn't give me much hope for the direction of the other three episodes.
Yes.
It really doesn't, with stuff like that going on. Camfield would have done better. But yeah.
Whereas in this one, he explodes.
I don't think
he explodes when he hits the ground.
I don't think they'd allow that. I think he'd probably turn into a doll, actually, in the same sort of way. Yeah. Go back to the toys thing.
Yeah.
Or he might turn into a pawn. He'd become a pawn. He'd become a pawn to replace one of the ones that was destroyed in the chess match.
Oh, yeah.
The devil was a pawn.
Yeah.
That's what. Yeah. Why?
We're all pawns here.
Yeah, forever.
He's a screaming pawn, isn't he?
Yeah.
What happens to Joey and Clara? Do they kind of go in a bit longer?
I don't know. I've just come up with a screaming porn. That's quite
all right. I like the screaming porn. I was hoping for more.
Stop saying screaming porn.
I can't help it. It's addictive.
I was hoping for more screaming porn from you.
I've shot my load on screaming porn.
Oh, dear.
We'll see.
I was just thinking that I would quite like to make them the same characters all the way through as well. I mean, obviously, they don't last all that long.
They should have done.
I don't know why.
So they can all end up with screaming poems.
They could all be screaming poems.
Sweet. Yeah.
Well, we could have, instead of the Queen of Hearts, you could have them being like a queen and a king on the chessboard.
Yeah.
True. Nice. But she becomes the Queen of Hearts. So I'll tell you what happens. Rory gets it wrong and he becomes a screaming pawn. And Amy goes, no, I'll give myself in exchange for Rory. Make me a screaming pawn instead and give him back his life. And the Queen goes, oh, that's lovely. And she grows a heart and becomes the Queen of Hearts and saves Rory with heart power. Do it.
Okay.
No.
Well, that's got the advantage that Rory dies. So, yeah, we can tick that.
Yeah, Rory dies.
He
can fall off and shatter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Puts a bit of jeopardy in. Dead. Briefly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then presumably Amy forgets him again.
Probably, yeah.
Because you'd forget seeing your husband turn into a screaming pawn and then shatter him. That would just go straight away. No retention of that at all. That's not going to leave scars.
Well, season six is all about how much Amy loves Rory, isn't it? So it's kind of, you know, really
it is. It is.
Dig into that a bit. Yeah.
Well, then, so that's that. Yeah, you get that extra sort of thing at the end while the doctor's about to do the last triangle. And then we go into the last where, you know, there's like 5 minutes of actual plot at the end. Suddenly it kicks off again, having stopped in episode one.
Well, the last bit is actually genuinely clever. I mean, it goes on way too long. It's more like 15 minutes. But they do have the bit where the doctor, he's finished his game. He can be seen again.
Yeah.
He's corporeal,
He's corporeal. Yeah. And then he refuses to do the last move. He wants to go back.
I love the way he's trying to out. He's doing like really shrewd out thinking to a mash of Sean Connery head on a spring. Well done, doctor. Make your last move.
Yeah, it's going to be impossible to tell it, seriously.
Does this mean that Matt Smith's going to have to do a kind of really terrible Sean Connery impression at the end to make the last move?
Yes, it does.
Go to move 511, you dodge.
This is a time ram I really, really wish to will into existence because I was watching the fuck out of it. This is tremendous. I love it. I cannot wait to see what Tumblr makes of it.
Yes.
Really, really want to
I
see
wonder,
it.
Yeah, I want to see the picture of
Sean
Connery's head on the Jack in the Box.
Yeah.
We should give a shout out to 6 and 7, who's been doing art for some Tumblr.
Love your work. Stuff. Loving everything you do.
Fantastic stuff on there.
Keep them coming. Really, really enjoy seeing them. Thank you.
I really loved... A good man fucks us up. Where they've actually gone in and thought about it and brought in some of the characters we've now had.
Yeah, and you know more about it than we do. I was looking at that and going, blimey, that's. And I thought, that's the kind of stuff I know about Doctor Who, though, isn't it? That's what I do with Doctor Who. So I know this behaviour.
spot on.
Stuff. Love it.
Particularly with the giant Donald Pleasance turn up.
Yes.
That was nice. That was nice to see that, yeah.
Yeah, so we get the final part of the story, really. Amy and Rory defeat Cyril.
No, Rory's a dead screaming pawn.
He's back again. They brought him back again. He's fine.
Is he brought back? Okay. Oh, the Queen of Hearts does bring him back with her.
Yeah. Well, you think he's going to stay dead? No, that's not what he does. That's not.
No, I just might stay dead for a little bit, but I'm easy. Live, dead, it's all good to me, you know.
Yeah, they defeat Cyril and his friends as Mario.
Yeah, Mario's a screaming pawn.
So the Doctor, he refuses to play his final move, and then he comes back, and they all go into the TARDIS. But they can't leave yet. They can't leave until the game ends. But when the game ends, that will destroy the Toymaker's realm, and they'll all disappear with it. So to win is to lose.
I wonder if they go out. I don't think they go out again. I think the Toymaker in the spring just appear in spectral form in the TARDIS.
Yes.
Okay.
Give it your last move.
So they do spend quite a long time talking about this.
Yes.
In the existing episode 4.
Just love the
It's almost as if they'd run out of story, isn't it?
Yes, almost, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
It does give us some nice shots of the fault locator for the last time.
Yes. Is that the last appearance of the fault locator?
The last appearance of the fault locator.
The fault locator.
Mm-hmm. Apart from it turns up as a slide in Tomb of the Cybermen. But it is but a slide. It's merely a projection of a fault locator rather than the real thing.
That's the one they did on film, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good to know these things.
Yes. I think they're just absolutely, yeah, BN fire thing.
Yeah. So, yes.
I'm either going to be doing that or I'm going to be doing more Sean Connery impersonations. It's up to you. It's up to you.
So they have to do their Sean impression.
Yeah.
Go to move 511, but he does it from the TARDIS, and then they hit dematerialize and they're away.
Yeah. Sean Connery goes, no! It explodes. I've always found that shot in the original of the world exploding. Well, it looks like they're blowing up a table lamp or something. There's a bit of china going up and round. What the hell are they doing there? What is this?
It's hard to represent, though, isn't it? I mean, where is the Toymaker's? Where are they? What is it?
Maker's place.
In Toymaker. It's a random explosion that got from
adjacent
somewhere
to the land of fiction.
Yeah. Will we set it in a void, do you think? Would it actually be in an actual sort of strange void place?
Well, we had a void at the beginning, didn't we, when they stepped out?
I quite like the idea of putting it in a hotel, but, you know, you could have it in a void or something weird.
Well, you think you'd do it a bit like the giggle, you know, they open a door and they're in a hotel.
Yeah.
You know, a door and a void, and then they open it again and they're in Pac-Man. You just do it like that, you'd have an instant change between locales when you go through a portal.
Yeah.
Of whatever kind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, having the Toymaker, when he's defeated, going back into his box kind of ties in with the giggle, doesn't it? Because in the end of that, he ends up in a box, doesn't he?
It does.
Does he?
So that's what happens when he gets defeated. He just ends up back in his box.
Put him in the box. Why not?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, the Doctor and the Toymaker do explicitly say at the start of the story that they've met previously. So clearly they met in the giggle.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
Which would have been the last story for Trouton or someone.
I was thinking Trouton. Yeah.
So
that'd be great, actually, Trouton the Toymaker. Yeah. Totally see that.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
Ensplinement.
I think that was infinitely better than the transmitted version.
Yeah.
Magnitude's better. It would really work. It does need modern day visuals to do the Toymaker world, I think.
Yeah.
I'm usually fine with the visuals in 60s stories. I don't feel let down by them. I think they're quite imaginative. I think this is imaginative, but there's a lot of studio floor going on.
It is one where the animation kind of helps because it's so. They can do so much more with the visuals. So it actually does feel like an alien place, you know.
Yeah. I think that's the cue you'd take on this. You could have all sorts of surrealism going on within acceptable budgets, but it's doable. It's doable. The technology is there. This is feasible stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, there are bits of it where it's kind of Hartnell Doctor Who at its most childlike. And people make excuses for it and go, oh, it's dark and what have you. And
really
you,
not,
you look at bits of it and you think, it's not really. It's not.
I go back to what I said earlier about the sort of embarrassing Crackerjack pantomimes, you know, just the feel of episode 4 and the sound of the rest of them, you know, very much makes it sound like that.
Apparently, it did go down quite well with the kids at the time. Unlike the gunfires.
But having said that, I'd be fascinated to see any episode of it, of course. Any missing episode is a bonus, but things I'd rather see.
I mean, if a missing episode turned up and it was, you know, Celestial Toymaker part 3 or something, I'd be quite disappointed.
If it was 3, I'd be disappointed. 2, I wouldn't mind seeing what the Shares stuff was like, but you know, as in what they actually did to people, to the dolls and stuff. One I wouldn't mind. One, of course, would get clips from Massacre and Masterplan, which would be great. But I bet it'd be really tiny and on the robot screen in its stomach.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't be all that good. But you could still
get a clip from them.
Put them recon-
I don't think you get a clip from the Massacre, would you?
You do, yeah. He says, that's me in Paris.
Oh, yes. Right, okay.
That's me on the planet Kemble, and that's me in Paris. I don't know which order around it is. And then
Dodo,
my mother died.
The Dodo, yeah. Dodo, they got her a funeral, haven't they? Or in front of some drapes, at the very least.
I mean, it would just be a shot of Stephen in a street with a way out hat on, I'm sure. But it would be, you know, some tiny seconds of the Massacre. But no, it didn't have the decency to be episode 1, it was episode 4. So there we are. I'll do some numbers. Shall I do some numbers?
What? Right.
Yeah.
William Hartnell is who we've got.
Oh, okay.
He's had quite a lot recently.
He's had loads, frankly. Give us some Trowan.
I can't. 254.
254?
No, that's me.
What are
they? Capaldi, maybe?
It's a Capaldi. It is Last Christmas.
What was that?
It's a Christmas one.
That's the one where they have the horrible aliens that sit on your face.
Oh, the crab things.
The crab things, dream crabs, and make you fantasize. You mean
Oh, this is going to be like the Morpho brains, then. It's going to be the Morpho brains sat on their fiercers, man. They are completely exposed to the Mesmeron.
Oh, great, and he can wish a Merry Christmas to all you at home at the end.
He's got a brain in his face.
In fact, he must.
So this is going to be 25 minutes on the 25th of December 1965, is it?
we'll have to make it a two-parter. It would be one on Christmas Day and one on New Year's Day.
Okay.
Doing the Christmas brains, man. Let's start with Santa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How dare you, sir? How dare you come aboard my ship? Just stop pissing up Santa. Oh, man, me, Chesterton. Get this Christmas out of my ship. And it would be Peter Glaze as well.
Oh, Peter Glaze.
As Santa.
Yeah, totally would.
I'm just your jack in the box, you know, whenever love knocks. I'm gonna bounce up and down on my spring.
That was a good episode, wasn't it? Did you like that episode? We like that episode, and if we like it, you like it. Thanks to Mr. Barry Williams.
You're welcome.
And Mr. Paul Ferry.
Goodbye.
I've been Rupert Booth. I expect to continue to be so. Find us. Find me, Doctor. As Rose once said. Then find us everywhere. Find us everywhere on the internet. You should know by now. Don't you know by now? I bet you do know by now. But Baz is going to make me go through it anyway because he's just a sadist, practically a Nazi. Twitter. We're on Twitter, where I'm at Rupert Booth. Baz is at Baz Time Ram, and Paul is at Paul Ferry 8. We are also on Tumblr. They are on Tumblr. I can't speak to Tumblr. What are you on? What are you on Tumblr, guys?
I am Baz Time Ram.
I have no idea.
You are that Paul Ferry.
Oh, I'm that Paul Ferry.
That's who you are.
Yes.
We thought we were organised before we started recording this, but yeah. Ebbed now.
We tried to be organised. It hasn't helped.
No.
Let's put it that way.
No, no. In all fairness, the people who made the Celestial Toymaker weren't very organised, so
no.
You know, we're fine. We're just following their footsteps. Yeah, we've got a Patreon site, you know, and there's lots of really good stuff on there. Look, I tell you what, if we actually make a 5-minute episode of Launch Hunter and put it up on the Patreon site, will you give us some money for that? Yeah? Come on, let us know. Say yes and we'll do it, but we'll actually do it. I'll do it, even if they don't, I'll just do it myself, it will happen. Anything else I need to say? Thanks to Ben Jones for our music. He's not a nonch. That's a lot.
Definitely not.
I'm just your jack in the box, because for your love I'd do anything.
I love my Michael Caine impression. It sounds nothing like Michael Caine.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, like my Sean Connery sounds like Sean Connery.
Well, you can't win them all, said Zebedee. Time for bed.
Direction point! Direction point!
A Doctor Who podcast network.